Now let's cover a fairly lengthy but important subject of upper airway respiratory distress. And it's important to remember that an upper airway obstruction can present mild all the way to severe and include the large airway anatomy such as the nose, the pharynx, or the larynx. Because children and infants have a much smaller airway than adults, in fact, if you look at a child's pinky or a baby's pinky, that's about the size of their trachea, they're more susceptible to those types of obstructions. And in a child or infant with a decreased level of consciousness, the tongue can cause an obstruction because the muscles relax and the tongue falls back into the back of the throat, obstructing the actual oral pharynx area of the airway. Food or small foreign body objects, infections like epiglottitis or croup, thick secretions in the nasal passages or swelling of the airway from a condition like anaphylaxis or epiglottitis are all common causes of upper airway obstruction. Less common but possible upper airway obstructions can be caused from such things as a mass like an abscess or a congenital condition in the airway or trauma even that causes narrowing of that same airway. The signs of an upper airway obstruction are different from lower airway obstruction in that the signs occur mostly during inspiration. Typically, the signs include inspiratory retractions, the use of accessory muscles, nasal flaring, hoarseness, snoring, drooling, a change in sound of their voice or cry, or that really, really common sound like that barking seal-like bark cough. That also is accompanied with the stridor-like sounds when auscultating lung sounds. Usually, as an upper airway obstruction worsens, breathing becomes more labored and faster. However, in the later stages with severe hypoxia, breathing becomes slower and actually will eventually stop altogether if left untreated. Early recognition, identification, and treatment of respiratory distress in infants and children is vital to their survival and good outcomes. Respiratory distress can quickly progress to respiratory failure and cardiac arrest. Treatment would include proper positioning of the patient so that they're most comfortable and they're in a position that keeps the airway open to help support breathing efforts. Now, this could include that the child's sitting upright so that their head is higher than their heart, or if they really are feeling distressed, they could even lean forward or hold a teddy bear. Anything that kind of helps them feel more comfortable decreases their stress level. Now next, we should probably check lung sounds and apply an oxygen saturation monitor while the child is still on room air. This will establish a good baseline for their SpO2 level. Now we're going to want to administer high flow oxygen right away for respiratory distress. Remember, the goal is to keep the oxygen sat above 94%. We could consider suctioning as needed, and after initial oxygen therapy is established, the assessment of their blood pressure, their pulse, their respiratory rate, their temperature, and a good ECG should all be the next things to follow. It's going to be important to identify and treat the specific upper airway obstruction based on the signs and symptoms. Now, croup is most commonly identified, like I said before, with that seal-like bark. Stridor lung sounds and possibly even retractions are going to be really visible in those severe cases. You know, usually lower lung sounds are clear. For croup, we want to administer nebulized epinephrine at 5 milliliters of 1 to 1,000 as indicated. When the initial airway treatment has been initiated, IV or IO access should be established in order to have an access point to give corticosteroids if that's needed. A commonly recommended corticosteroid is dexamethasone. 0.6 milligrams per kilogram, we deliver that IV or IO. Now reassess the vitals after the initial treatment and monitor our patient closely. It's a good idea to be prepared to intubate in case respiratory failure occurs. For things like anaphylaxis, intramuscular epinephrine or an auto-injector would be the first emergency treatment. Corticosteroids, albuterol, and antihistamines can also be administered depending on the signs and symptoms. If a child or infant has a foreign body airway obstruction where they cannot cough or breathe, it needs to be removed immediately with proper basic life support. Now we're going to use certain techniques like abdominal thrusts, back slaps, or chest thrusts. But for a mild foreign body obstruction, as an aspiration where the child's able to make sounds and cough forcefully, one should not try to physically remove it, but rather call for expert consultation if time allows. And if the patient's status remains stable, you can still see if maybe a surgical or a deep suction might be called for. Allowing the child to remain in the position of comfort and monitor them closely for deterioration. And if they do deteriorate, we want to treat them accordingly.